Good afternoon. I'm Stanley Palisada. Exactly 1 year ago, 70 Philippine lawmakers rejected a franchise application of ABS-CBN, changing the landscape of Philippine media and the lives of thousands of workers. 1 year on, the fight to bring the network back on air remains.
Late on the table, Mr. Chair.
Kill.
Re-renew ng application ng ABS-CBN ay hindi lang po isinantabi. Ito po ay tinapos na ngayong araw na ito, Mr. Chair. Tama po ba?
That is correct.
Hindi man na-renew ang aming prangkisa, nangangako kami sa inyo. Hindi kami mananahimik sa pag-ataking ito sa ating demokrasya at sa malayang pamamahayan.
In the service of the Filipino. Now signing off.
Since ABS-CBN's franchise denial, several other franchises have been passed by Congress for one lawmaker that only proves the network's shutdown was politically motivated. RG Cruz with that full story.
Kulang sila na hindi lang pagkukulang.
Ang yes, 11 ang no. Dalawa nag-inhibit, isa ang nag-abstain. The resolution to deny ABS-CBN's franchise application is hereby adopted.
It's been a year since the House Committee on Legislative Franchises killed the franchise of the country's largest network, ABS-CBN. In that year, Congress approved many franchises. All in all, since the start of the 18th Congress in July 2019, 23 franchises were either signed by the President or allowed to lapse into law. Congressman Carlos Arate, who backed the ABS-CBN franchise renewal, points out the difference between how Congress handled those other franchises and the ABS-CBN franchise. ABS-CBN went through 13 grueling hearings after its franchise expired.
In several instances in the past, and even after the denial of the franchise of ABS-CBN, marami silang pinapalusot na prangkisa na meron ding mga pagkukulang. No? Binigay nila at nirenew nila. In fact, niratsada pa yung ibang mga prangkisa dyan sa Committee on Legislative Franchises just to mapagbigyan yung mga interests behind these franchises.
Regarding the franchise bills that we approved, that you mentioned, each franchise is evaluated on its own. The Congress's or the House's or the committees or the House's action on one application cannot be made the basis of saying that this should have been granted.
Zarate also pointed out the inconsistency in the position of congressmen when it comes to foreign ownership, which was raised during the ABS-CBN franchise hearing. One accusation is that the franchise law was violated because then ABS-CBN chairman Gabby Lopez is a dual Filipino and American citizen. Lopez had insisted he has Filipino citizenship.
I am a natural born Filipino citizen because both my parents are Filipino citizens.
Parang kinain ng Kongreso yung kanyang mga sinabi, no? Ang daming franchise na pinasa, no? The latest yung Chacha proposal nga that even allows foreign ownership sa media institutions, which they made it a big passion issue during the franchise hearing, no? Dahil daw hindi Filipino si Mr. Lopez, Gabby Lopez.
But for Deputy Speaker Garcia, their approval of the Chacha resolution doesn't mean an automatic approval of foreign ownership of media.
The premise, I think, is flawed. It's not a self-executing measure. No? Future Congresses will have to determine whether to relax foreign ownership of lands or foreign ownership of media in the Philippines.
For Zarate, it's clear as day, ABS-CBN's franchise was politicized. Garcia stands by the findings of the Committee Technical Working Group, which deliberated and heard evidence and testimonies. This report became the basis to deny the franchise. The 18th Congress has 300 congressmen, but only the 85 members of the Committee on Legislative Franchises decided the fate of the EBS-CBN franchise. This didn't reach the plenary because it tied in the committee under the House rules. 1 year after, the House has yet to release an official list of how congressmen voted. Individual votes were not broadcasted. Only the score went on air, 70-11 against franchise renewal. When the 18th Congress opens its final regular session this month after President Duterte delivers his final State of the Nation address on July 26, Congress won't likely tackle the EBS-CBN franchise. Both lawmakers believe the fate of EBS-CBN now rests upon the shoulders of the next Congress.
I think the Speaker has already said that the House has acted on the matter, and this is for is an action for future Congresses should another application be filed by ABS-CBN.
This is not an issue lang, RG, of ang ABS-CBN, the owners ang nawalan, no? It's more than that, no? It's an issue that involves the Filipino people, no? Their choice to have a source, no, na credible sa information, and yun yung nawala. And ang pumalit nun, ay nagkaroon nga ng some sort of chilling effect doon sa other platforms, no, or other media entities.
RG Cruz, EBS-CBN News.
A law expert regrets that the Supreme Court did not step in during the franchise hearing of ABS-CBN. Attorney Theodore Te, who was himself serving as spokesperson for the High Court, says it could have issued a temporary restraining order at the height of the franchise hearings. This, as he notes, the House Committee on Legislative Franchises overstepped its duties by acting as a court, even when several government agencies cleared the network of any wrongdoing.
Di na ako magsispeculate kung bakit hindi gumalaw yung korte. But magandang opportunity sana yun, no? Na dahil nga ang papel ng hukuman, no, lalo na dito yung Supreme Court, no, kapag nagbabanggaan na yung dalawang institusyon, magandang oportunidad sana yun na sabihin ng korte, sandali lang, pwede ba natin itong tingnan sa isang siguro more dispassionate manner, no? Dahil nga mainit na yung talakayan sa
Te says what the public can do now is to never forget that this all happened under the Duterte administration.
Huwag kalimutan na minsan sa kasaysayan natin, no, naulit yung pagpatay sa isang network, no? Kasi nga ABS-CBN enjoys the dubious distinction of being the network that was shut down twice, eh, no, under two different administrations. The only difference was, at least in Marcos's martial law, no, hindi nagpanggap. Eh, kasi martial law, eh. Ito dinaan sa isang, kumbaga, maladimokratikong pagdedeliberasyon, eh, no? Pero ganun din ang mangyari. Siguro, every chance na maging issue ito, no, at ito ay dahil papalapit ng eleksyon, no, ay tanungin yung 70 na bumoto dun sa committee, no, na sila ba ay naninindigan pa dun sa boto nila.
ABS-CBN shutdown is the single worst scandal under the Duterte administration. That declaration coming from Philippine Daily Inquirer columnist John Neri. But Neri believes the more ambitious politicians in the Duterte government have now realized they won't make it into office without a media outlet like ABS-CBN. This is why Neri says the network shutdown will be a factor in next year's election.
I think that we should all focus on, we should all ask candidates for the House, the Senate, and the presidency, do you support a new franchise for ABS-CBN? At the very least, put them on record. I think that, in fact, the ABS-CBN issue is the single most, is the single worst scandal that hit Duterte, or in Duterte's term. People up to now are still outraged. And it should be used as a battering ram against political ambition.
As for veteran journalist Inday Espina Varona, the ABS-CBN shutdown shows threats to press freedom should not be taken sitting down. She says more has to be done to protect press freedom as those in power try to stamp it out.
Whatever considerations, other considerations there are, you can pursue those considerations without letting up, without letting up on our stand on press freedom. It's not enough to hold the line when people like this rule. We should push and push and push because increasingly they're trying to crowd us in.
The president of the ABS-CBN Rank and File Employees Union says many workers who lost their livelihood due to the network shutdown have yet to find new jobs. John Villanueva says the pandemic has made it even harder for them to find work. He adds those who did find new jobs had to work in professions in a completely different field.
Kasi para po makasurvive, yung iba po pumasok sa mga food deliveries. Yung iba naman po, nagtayo ng karinderya, ng iba, naging panadero po. Pinipilit po nilang makasurvive. Kaya kahit anong klase ng trabaho ay kanila pong pinapasok.
Defend Jobs Philippines, meanwhile, says the shutdown has caused a domino effect wherein businesses reliant on the network for income also took a hit.
Mga outsourcing, advertising reliant businesses, mga micro, small and medium enterprises, na mga food and service accommodations, so kasama din yung mga caterers, mga wardrobe assistants, PA, visual artists, mga restaurant owners and bar owners, kahit po yung simpleng mga vendors.
A member of the Human Rights Watch dares the 70 lawmakers who voted against the renewal of ABS-CBN's franchise bid to come out and stand up to their vote, calling the lack of transparency on their decision cowardly. 1 year since its franchise bid was rejected, the House of Representatives has yet to release an official list of how each congressman at the Committee on Legislative Franchises voted.
Franchise bill po.
They will not do that because they know that their no vote for the franchise was a mistake, that it was a move that was pressure, that was a result of a pressure from the president, and they are not, they're so cowardly that they're not willing to put face to their votes, especially in the upcoming elections. I'd be brutally frank about this, okay? You'd have to be monumentally clueless or even stupid not to see this for what it is, that this was a political move by this regime to silence ABS-CBN.
Only 11 lawmakers in the House of Representatives Committee on Legislative Franchises voted to grant the network a fresh franchise. We have one of them with us, House Deputy Speaker Bienvenido Abante Jr. Good afternoon, sir.
Hi, good afternoon, Stanley. Good afternoon to all of the listeners of the ANC.
Thanks again for taking time to be with us today. Sir, during last year's hearing of the Committee on Legislative Franchises at the House of Representatives, you were adamant that ABS-CBN did not violate any provision on its old franchise and must be given a new one. Now, how did it feel when your colleagues promptly and decisively denied a franchise application on the committee level?
Well, first of all, I'd like to say this. They say that hindsight is 20/20, which means that in most cases, one can have a clearer view of one's decisions or actions in the past because you have had the time to think about your actions and to see its effects. In that context, I would have to say that I believe that my vote to last year's granting ABS-CBN a franchise was the right thing to do, given what we knew then and given what we know now. I know I cannot speak with the rest that did not vote for the franchise, but I guess they have all the right to do what they want to do. But I believe that what I did was the right thing to do. I remember the verse in the Bible that says when you know how to do good and you do it not, to him it is sin. And I think that I voted something good at that time.
Yes, getting on a bit of highlights from last year's hearing, what are your thoughts on the inconsistencies in terms of the handling of the ABS-CBN franchise hearing at the committee level? ABS-CBN was subjected to severe treatment by embarrassing its key people, while other outfits applying for a franchise did not go through the same level of scrutiny.
You know, when I voted for the franchise of ABS-CBN, I looked into every detail of the argument and discussion. And even if the rest of those that did not vote find a lot of what we may term to be illegal or not proper, I would look at it and I said, everything is proper, you know? I even said at the time that according to several regulatory agencies, ABS-CBN has been complying with laws and regulations regarding broadcast networks. And during our hearings, the BIR said the network had been paying its taxes. The SEC said that their PDRs had been approved, the DOLE, you know. I mean, all of this testified in favor of ABS-CBN. So whatever the inconsistencies are, to me, it's not actually proper.
All right. Still on the manner by which the hearing was conducted, was the committee even supposed to act like a court in this case? I'm referring to a reaction from Secretary Tedde, former spokesman of the Supreme Court, Tedde. What do you make of the demeanor of some of your colleagues during that hearing?
In reality, I would think that the committee hearing, I said this plainly also last year, that the committee hearing is not a court and they are not to pass judgment.
Although it behaved like one.
Well, they behaved like a court, that's true. Mm-hmm. And it should not be, because that hearing should only be able to tell us whether the ABS-CBN has been compliant. If not, we take a vote. But the thing is this, that vote should have been put into the plenary. Ibig sabihin, the whole plenary ought to vote on it, not just the committee members, you see.
Okay, sir, following the grueling weeks, of course, of hearings, a decision was reached to deny the franchise application. Did you see this coming? I mean, was it a lost cause from the start?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, you know, the reason why I said that it's not the committee hearing is at the court, because it's more of a political exercise than actually a real judgment call, you know. And when it comes to politics in Congress, you cannot do anything about it except that you ought to vote according to your own conscience. That's the only thing. You see, to me, it's more political than anything else.
Okay, speaking of political decisions, those who were in favor of granting ABS-CBN a franchise were said to have taken a political suicide. How did their action affect their political careers now?
Thing is, if that would be political suicide on my part, I would rather be truthful than try to skirt the issue, no? I've all along, in all of my political exercise or mandate, I have not been afraid to stand to what I believe is right. Whether they call it political suicide, then it is still the people that would make a decision on it. To me, I believe what I did was right. It was good, not only for ABS-CBN, but for the Filipino people as well. Not only for the owners of ABS-CBN, but for the 11,000 workers in ABS-CBN that would be out of work if we don't give them a franchise.
Yes, sir. At the start of this interview, you said at 2020 hindsight, you thought you did the right thing, and any right thing must be sustained. How do you suggest we continue to fight and press for a franchise or for justice in this case?
I think that the first thing I would do if ever I get reelected is again file a bill granting ABS-CBN a franchise, not only because of the owners and leaders of ABS-CBN, but for the Filipino people as well. Because look, ABS-CBN is the only network in the country that goes into the rural areas. No network in this country ever goes to the very remote and rural areas in the Philippines where our senior citizens, most of all, do not have any idea of what is happening in this country. So I mean, I would file a bill granting a franchise. And I believe that this time, in the 19th Congress, this time, our congressmen, I believe they would grant it. Naniniwala ako doon, they would grant it.
All right. On that very positive note, thank you. It was good to have you join us today, sir.
Thank you, Stanley. Thank you very much.
Salamat po. Up next, we break down the losses not only of the network, but of the whole media industry when ABS-CBN's franchise bid was denied. Stay tuned. This is ANC special coverage to mark 1 year since the House of Representatives voted to kill ABS-CBN's bid for a fresh franchise.
Application. Ito po ay tinapos na ngayong araw na ito, Mr. Jer.
Nangangakos kami sa inyo, hindi kami mananahimik sa pag-ataking ito sa ating demokrasya at sa malayang pamamahayan.
Now signing off.
Back on May 5, 2020, the National Telecommunications Commission issued a cease and desist order on ABS-CBN's operations after its franchise officially lapsed a day before. The order meant closing down the network's free-to-air services, resulting in millions of Filipinos losing their trusted news and entertainment source. It also meant billions of pesos in losses for the company. In its disclosure to the Philippine Stock Exchange, ABS-CBN said it incurred a net loss of 13.5 billion pesos in 2020. That's over 400% higher compared to the previous amount in 2019. The drop was mainly due to the loss of advertising revenues, which plunged nearly 70% for the year. For 2021, the net loss in the first quarter was at 1.9 billion pesos, despite an aggressive digital rollout. This as the scale-down operations continues to be aggravated by the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic. Because of the financial costs of the shutdown, ABS-CBN was also forced to close its subsidiaries. That included the regional stations, dealing a big blow to viewers who had been relying on them for their source of news, especially during disasters. A total of 53 regional TV and radio stations went off air on August 28th, with thousands losing their jobs in the process.
Hindi nila naiintindihan na hindi lang siya work na nawala sa iyo. It's a family that you're going to leave. It's a home that na parang nasisira. Iba kasi yung effect pag ikaw empleyado pa, ikaw kapamilya ka.
Aside from regional stations, non-core businesses were also shut down, including Kidzania Manila, the interactive city made for kids, and the O Shopping Channel, which was a joint venture between ABS-CBN and South Korean firm CJENM. By the end of 2020, the company disclosed that it had only 5,932 employees, including independent contractors. That's nearly half of the 11,071 figure that ABS-CBN reported during the franchise hearings in July 2020. The whole media industry has been affected by the denial of the ABS-CBN franchise. For the president of the National Union of People's Journalists, Jonathan De Santos, the network's closure has left a void in information dissemination about various issues, including the upcoming polls.
With the loss of ABS-CBN, with the loss of information, it'll be more difficult for voters to decide or to choose their leaders, no? And also it gives parang it gives space for disinformation and for yeah, fake news nga, as they say, no. There's a bigger space for that it will make it harder for journalists and others to combat.
Let's dive deep into the chilling effects of the ABS-CBN franchise denial on the dissemination of information and the media industry as a whole. We have with us Center for Media Freedom and Responsibility Executive Director Melinda Quintos de Jesus. Good afternoon, sir. Ma'am.
Good afternoon. How are you? Yes.
I'm fine. Hope you're safe too. CMFR Executive Director de Jesus, welcome to the program. Now, apparent in the killing of the ABS-CBN franchise are two main goals. One of which is weaponizing the granting of broadcast licenses and, of course, the demonizing of a critical press. Now, to what extent did those opposed to granting ABS-CBN a license achieve those intentions, in your view?
The achievement of those intentions? Meaning, I mean, what kind of resistance has taken place?
Have they succeeded? Have they succeeded in terms of those two goals?
In terms of actually limiting and chilling, the chilling effect is real. I mean, Center for Media Freedom and Responsibility monitors coverage. And we had, even before the closure of ABS-CBN, already noted how many stories were not being told and how more carefully media had become in reporting some of the sensitive stories. Investigative reporting, that's one of the frontline achievements of the media in the Philippines has been to set the standards for investigative reporting for the region and even competing on the level of global media. Mm-hmm. And yet, there are no longer any investigative teams, partly because of the cost of such investigative teams, but also because, I think, of the fear that has taken over the newsrooms. I mean, I think when something like this happens to the biggest player in the field, you cannot but expect others to say, if it can happen to them, it'll happen to us. And so the message was very clear. It was already emerging even before the decision not to renew the franchise. And it has basically taken over in terms of the dynamic of many newsrooms. When we get asked these days about whether there is still press freedom, that press freedom is dependent only on the numbers that still want to come forward and speak up. And a divided newsroom becomes a weaker newsroom. A divided media community also becomes a weaker media community. So the damage is real. The damage is real, not just on the news practice, but also on the effect of what or how news has to be. I mean, we used to be known as the most free, rambunctious even, irreverent even. We've had occasions to speak to other heads of state, and they have said, I would love to be able to get the questions that Philippine media will pose to their leaders, because that will test my own ability to be able to take that kind of heat. That was where we were.
Right.
And we are no longer there. And I think that is a loss, not just for the media, because the media freedom operates not for its own good, but for the good of the people. You get more news out there. If media is courageous and unafraid, then you also have a people sovereign enough, confident enough that they are the power and that government must be afraid of how they will make these decisions when they can express these decisions.
Ms. De Jesus, you mentioned people. Two liberties were actually eroded when they stopped ABS-CBN from operating its broadcast platform. Of course, freedom of the press, free media, as you said, and access to the press. Now, many communities far from the capital have relied on the network's broadcast service for news and information. Now, how devastating is it for the general public to be denied access to these important commodities?
It is absolutely, it is like killing them off. I mean, we don't live by bread alone. We know that. Mm-hmm. And the dynamic spirit that lives in the communities that has been fed by free community media, the ones that are working in the provinces, I have always identified that as a clear sign that we are a stronger democracy. Once you take that out, mm-hmm. and the feedback that connects them, as ABS-CBN did, connecting the most remote community, most locations that are not as we are in the National Capital Region, of course, there is a loss, a complete loss. Let's not talk about news alone.
Right.
What about their need for entertainment, for distraction?
Right.
I mean, I have had people in beauty parlors basically said, when they are not so politicized, basically said, ano mangyayari? What is going to happen to our programs that we come home to at night, that I watch on my little digital gadget, etc.? You know, these is an attack against communities that depend on what the media provides, include political information, which is very important, but also the caring and the humanitarian aspect, which is to give them the opportunities to be distracted and to be entertained and to gather around of the hearth, as one would say, that TV or whatever gadget it is that they may use, that has had a function in gathering these families together.
All right. During the hearings, many of those who challenged the franchise argued that ABS-CBN did not air positive government programs and initiatives. They challenged any news organization, in fact, not just ABS-CBN. It's right to exercise editor judgment in choosing which stories to air and how these are to be told. What are your thoughts on the fact that many of our politicians still think they have the right to control the narrative? I mean, how did networks and other media outfits deal with the chilling effect of this objective?
When we heard our elected officials speak in that manner, as though they did not understand the function of the fourth pillar of democracy, I felt we are at the beginning of the end. This is doomsday, because these people needed the people's votes to be able to speak in that manner. And the least they can do is at least observe the spirit of the Constitution, which upholds the freedom of media from government interference. I have always said that it's always been a problem in the Philippines that we have placed this power in the hands of elected politicians, and that we have had a pattern of Congress simply following the dominant political party that is in power. How then are we going to be able to assure that this will not happen again? We really should explore the different ways in which in different West democracies, not just in the West, the establishment of an independent commission, let it be a constitutional commission, that will operate with the independence in order to decide when someone or a unit or an agency, a media organization, retains its franchise. We should understand what the franchise actually is. It was instituted in the beginning in order to place order in the bandwidths. Technology has taken care of some of those issues. But yes, there should be regulation, because broadcast is a regulated medium. But that regulation is only on some of its operative aspects. Joaquin Bernas, who is now dead, no longer with us, a constitutional expert, from the very beginning in our discussions in CMFR, where he sat on our board, basically said the principle is when there is failure in any of the business issues, then they penalize them for those business issues. They can never close it down for those reasons. Why? Because the Constitution is so clear in terms of how we must preserve the independence of the press. If I am dependent on any mayor for my business permit, how free am I going to be in covering City Hall? And City Hall is the one that holds power over the communities there out there that have, because they have gained the kind of autonomy for their cities to govern as they would. And therefore, at that level, the power and the capacity to critique, to question, to expose what is going on if it is not for the good of the public. That is the reason we have our democracy.
Yes, Mr. Jesus, another sad reality I've seen arising from this entire experience is the altering of public perception on what media is and what it does. Now, in killing an established independent media institution, they empowered alternative media. As evidence of this is the proliferation of outfits that dish out fake news. Now, what can journalists do to prevail and withstand these attacks?
To keep doing what they in their system, in our system, the press system, is a verified process. Nobody just goes out there. We submit it to checks of others to check the facts, etc. We need to talk a little bit more about these, I think, and we need to talk, perhaps begin this kind of campaign to educate as well the people that we, the officials that we elect into Congress, because apparently they are elected without having the sufficient background or understanding or appreciation of what journalists have to do in order to fulfill the function that they have been given in the Constitution. However, let me point out that the journalists can only do so much. The function of correcting or standing or pushing back against fake news is a societal challenge. It has to be engaging all the different sectors, classrooms, even the church, because the church and faiths of different kinds do rest on fundamental reliance of belief. And that freedom of believing and that freedom of forming one's opinion is what makes for a society that is able to protect its rights and to preserve its own capacity and to build up, in fact, that capacity in order that it is larger than what the state can muster on its through its agents. You know, the idea in a democracy is that the government should only be able to do so much in terms of pursuing its policy objectives. If it crosses the line in terms of going against fundamental rights of the members of society, then it has become less democratic, it has become more despotic, it has become more tyrannical. Mm-hmm. And I think the decision is made and has to be made not just by the institutions, which we have not heard from, unfortunately. That has been the effect of fear. That has been the shared cowardice of so many in society. But that it is something, not just the institutions, but the individuals themselves. And we have to build not just on the electoral power, although that becomes the actual measure, not just on the electoral power, but to make sure that that election is functioning in terms of expressing the true desire of Filipinos.
All right, thanks for those insights. That's all the time we have for now. Thanks for joining us, Mrs. Melinda De Jesus. Thank you. Overwhelming support continues to pour in on social media with the hashtag Ibalik ang ABS-CBN or Return ABS-CBN becoming a top trending topic on Twitter on Saturday. Twitter users at Reams Vincent commends the network for not losing its passion of helping and serving Filipinos despite a year without a franchise. Sugar David tweets a photo of ABS-CBN's main building facade at dusk, lighted with its red, green, and blue colors, saying, "We will rise again," along with the hashtag, Kapamilya Forever. Ria Vanessa also sharing a photo of what could be her car with a poster that says she is not an employee, but she supports ABS-CBN. Finally, Justin Dison tells lawmakers who voted against ABS-CBN's franchise that the people won't forget what they did to the thousands of employees and to freedom of press. We're off to a break. When we come back, we'll talk to another House lawmaker who voted to grant ABS-CBN a new franchise. Stay with us.
Application, ito po ay tinapos na ngayong araw na ito, Mr. Jer.
Nangangakos kami sa inyo, hindi kami mananahimik sa pag-ataking ito sa ating demokrasya at sa malayang pamamahayan.
Now signing off.
Hindi kami mananahimik sa pag-ataking ito sa ating demokrasya at sa malayang pamamahayan.
Now signing off.
Welcome back to ANC's special coverage to mark 1 year since the House of Representatives voted to kill ABS-CBN's bid for a fresh franchise. Let's talk to another one of the so-called Brave 11 who voted to grant the network a fresh franchise. We have with us Bayan Muna Party List Representative Carlos Sarate. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, Stanley.
Welcome to the program, Congressman Sarate. Congressman, you were one to believe last year that after all the examination of voluminous documents and the grilling of both the heads of government regulatory agencies as well as ABS-CBN executives, that none of the accusations of violations of ABS-CBN to its franchise has been proven. Now, you said that yourself in your summation. How did it feel when majority just voted against it?
Yes, it truly dampened one's spirit, no? Because after 12-day marathon hearings, this is, I think, the first time in the history of that committee, the Committee on Legislative Franchises, where an applicant for a franchise went through the needle, so to speak. No? But after everything has been said and done, and after all the regulatory agencies or representatives of these regulatory agencies testified and concluded that there are no violations, even if there are in the past, these were already remedied and already addressed. 70 members of the committee find it not enough and eventually rejected the application for a franchise of ABS-CBN. And I think it was very clear in our summation, the collective effort that we have, you know, the authors, to present all of these things. Because, Stanley, there is this doctrine in law, doctrine on primary jurisdiction, that when regulatory agencies task under our system to look after this, for example, a franchise holder like ABS-CBN, and the decisions or these sentences or statements coming from this regulatory agency should be given weight. Even the Supreme Court has several decisions respected, you know, the decisions and the position of regulatory agencies. So, truly, after these 12-day marathon hearings last year, we are confident that we have adequately presented strong arguments for the grant of for the renewal of the franchise. But then again, 70 of our colleagues see it differently, and they decided to deny the franchise application.
Yes, Congressman Sarate, in its final decision, the committee said that the ABS-CBN franchise was killed, in those exact words. Now, how powerful and even skewed the wording is?
That only goes to show, as I've said in several instances, that even prior to the summation, even prior to these hearings, I think there was already a decision to really not grant the franchise of ABS-CBN. And it comes from ex cathedra, no? If I may say, from the seat of authority, from Malacanang, no? Because of the several statements coming from the president himself. No? Even if Congress will grant a franchise, he will have just to veto it, no? If it reaches his table. No? So that, I think that gives so much weight why many of our colleagues decided to vote not to grant the franchise. So whatever these representatives of regulatory agencies will say, it will not matter anymore, no? Because there is that decision not to renew the franchise to follow what is the wishes of Malacañang.
Yeah, Congressman Sarate, your position in favor of a franchise renewal for ABS-CBN put you at risk for direct attacks from no less than the president. Now, were you prepared for this?
We expected that we will be vilified further in public, no? But of course, coming himself from the president, we did not expect to. I personally did not expect that it will go that in that kind of extent. No, it was more of a personal attack than an attack on how we address or how we voted based on our principles. No? But I think that's part of our position, that we have to stand on our ground, that we believe that it is right, not only for ABS-CBN, for the owners of ABS-CBN, but for the sake of for the bigger issues like the freedom of the press, no? Mm-hmm. Like the right of our people to free information, if we will not grant the franchise to ABS-CBN. I think there was this one study that the immediate effect after the closure or the non-grant of the franchise to ABS-CBN, 6 million people, 6 million about a million of our kababayans did not have an access anymore to credible information, you know, because of the non-operations or the closure, especially of the regional networks of ABS-CBN. So as you can see, the effect is not only to the owners of the ABS-CBN, to the 11,000 workers and their dependents, but in the generally to the public at large. You know? Emblematic of how the closure of ABS-CBN, emblematic of how our institutions, our democratic processes are being weaponized, no? Just to follow, no? The kind of narrative that the present dispensation wants.
Okay, sir, as a last question, you defended ABS-CBN because you believed it provided a voice to the defenseless, as it is critical of government. Now, how big a loss, a moral loss, if you will, was the shutdown to these two tenets that you hold so dearly?
I think we cannot calculate how big it is, no? But certainly it affected. As I've said before, no, the effect is incalculable. No? You cannot count it in terms of, you know, money loss, time loss, but I think it is a direct effect on our democratic institutions, how our democracy will work, no, in the country. But in the end, Stanley, no, probably one lesson that we have to get from this experience, because this is actually not new. It happened before during the time of the dictator Marcos, and it happened again. So I think that there's a bigger lesson that have to be learned, no? And in the coming months and in the coming years, I think it is very important that we should not allow this kind of situation to continue. As we have said, no, during the time of the martial law, never again and never forget.
Right.
And moving forward, we have to press forward. No, we have to push back. No? And moving forward, I think it has been shown that we can rise from this situation. We can wake up from this nightmare. In fact, we can crawl out, I think, from this kind of virtual torture chamber that we have now. We may be bruised, blooded even, but I'm pretty sure, no, that we will still continue to trudge on unbowed, and continue to perform our duty, to the public at large, in the service of the people, in the service of the Filipino people.
And just like you, Congressman, we look forward to better days. Thanks for your time. Thanks for sparing some moments with us to talk about your insights on the ABS-CBN shutdown. Thank you.
Thank you, Stanley. Stay safe.
A pleasant good afternoon to you. And that's ANC special coverage to mark 1 year since the House of Representatives voted to kill ABS-CBN's franchise bid. I'm Stanley Palisada. 1 year on, the fight to bring the network back on air remains. Thanks for joining us. Keep it here on ANC.
Renew ng application. Ito po ay tinapos na ngayong araw na ito, Mr. Chair.
Nangangako kami sa inyo, hindi kami mananahimik sa pag-ataking ito sa ating demokrasya at sa malayang pamamahayag.
Now signing off.